Okay, good morning, and
to be pushing what where.
Welcome to this week's edition of NCompass Live. I am your host, Krista Burns, here at the Nebraska Library Commission. NCompass Live is the Commission's weekly online event where we cover anything that may be of interest to librarians across the state and across the country. We do these sessions live every Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. Central Time. But they are recorded, so you can go back, you can go onto our website and find the recordings of every single NCompass Live show that we've done since we started in January 2009.
Wow.
Yeah. we do a mixture of things here, presentations, book reviews, mini training sessions, demos of things, basically anything vaguely related to libraries, and we'll put it on the show.
So vaguely related to libraries. Vaguely, now I know where I stand.
Well, there are some that begin a little maybe. And we have commission staff that do presentations for us, but we also bring in guest speakers as we have this morning. Sitting next to me, you can't see her now, but when we had the camera up there, is Lauren Riedzel from the Beatrice Public Library, just south of here, of Lincoln. And she's going to tell us about, obviously, here, the history of Carnegie Libraries in general, but mainly in Nebraska.
Yes, I really try to focus on Nebraska. In fact, it actually, I think originally the title said Carnegie Libraries in Nebraska, the good, the bad, the beautiful. So everyone else is going to be left out for this
That's
morning.
Okay. Learn all about Nebraska. So I'll just hand it over to you to take it away. You can go ahead and use the mouse. There's the
great
button.
We'll see. Perfect. We'll see if this works. Well, I should jump into the bad first, just so to get that out of the way for anybody who's saying, what a nasty woman. Here's these Carnegie Libraries. They're landmarks. They got us started. How can she say that? So I'm going to tell you why I think what I think the bad of them was. First of all, it started the expectation that libraries were going to be paid for by someone else. In that case, I mean library buildings. And so there's people who thought that then, and there's libraries to this very day that will tell you that Lincoln is one example, that their main central library has always been paid for by funds from somewhere else. So as they face their future, that's part of the challenge. I've had this happen to Beatrice. Politicians got up and said, we never had to pay for our library. We never should have to. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that that's what Carnegie exactly had in mind, but that's one of the bad things about it. The other is that these buildings themselves were not designed by librarians. And although they were designed for the public, and the public as they understood it, there are many, many issues with the way that they were designed. It's what made a lot of us move out of them, from the size to the fact that technology was so difficult with them. And then there's all those steps and ADA.
Uh-huh.
So the very structure of the buildings.
That was not something at all even thought about or taken in consideration back when they
It was the reverse. The whole idea was literally in a physical way, not just a symbolic way, that you were climbing up to knowledge. So Carnegie's love steps. And anybody who's ever been to a Carnegie knows that you see a lot of steps. So I'm going to tell you that right up front so that now we can just revel in the good and the beautiful. This is here just to show off something. When I first put this presentation together back in 2009, that was the recent, in fact, I think it was the newest Public Libraries magazine. And if you look at that, this is us. This is us talking to each other. And yet, what do? We use an image that looks like a Carnegie building from the past. There's the steps. There's the big entrance. There's the fancy roof. I mean, there's the lion. But that look of a building that we might associate with a Carnegie is right there with us all of the time. We still use it to this day. And of course, here's our good buddy Andrew Carnegie. Have no illusions about Andrew Carnegie. He got his money because he did all the things that people, millionaires, do to get hold of money, which means people somewhere are being hurt. That's just the nature of it. He was very, very successful. And part of the rehabilitation of his image was giving money not just to public libraries, but to things like churches for organs. He knew where to go, who were going to say the good things about him. Well, it'd be nice to have ministers saying good things about you. It'd be nice to have librarians, people who are hopefully have some kind of credibility, are giving out information. And he also saw the power of this. He actually used the formation of a library to settle at least one strike. So, yes, the idea, the promise that people's children would have access to, at least in the future, because Carnegie was never that interested in children's services, but the idea that a community would have a library to use. Now, of course, without him, that's the good part. It's hard to imagine library development, particularly in those states like Nebraska that are newer states, without someone like Andrew Carnegie. I'm not going to go at there's many parts of this that could be a whole topic all their own, and Andrew Carnegie is one of those, so I'm not going to get bogged down in that. I brought this just simply so you could see some correspondence. This is one, and I think this is just classic. This was our very first librarian, and you notice that this is September 10th, 1902, it looks like.
Okay.
And they opened the library in January of 1903 in Beatrice. And so they're trying to get this right. And you notice that they wrote this nice letter. Please note, by the way, her library science back end so that you could write cards and they would look lovely. But she basically, they want to make sure they're pronouncing his name correctly, which is interesting because they never did. To my knowledge, in Beatrice, we call it Carnegie like everybody else, not Carnegie. But you notice the band did not merit an entire letter back. And of course, they certainly didn't call. The man just wrote right on the letter how to pronounce it and sent it right back to her. So I always think that's funny that we don't really have that. This is the only other correspondence we have in our files. And it is from the secretary who really ran this program. And who micromanaged the building decisions and argued around with architects, and who was really the person that handled it on behalf of Carnegie. So the people who are hoping to have signed letters from Andrew Carnegie are going to be disappointed when they go back and look in their archive. The other thing is that these were negotiated with the cities in many cases, even though in our case we already had a library board. But some of you will not be able to find things in library minutes. You'd have to go back to the cities because they're the ones who had to promise to set up library boards to basically honor the fact that this was going to be a library and not the new city hall, which was a great fear. But and the other thing that just cracks me up is, look at that letter. I mean, who would send out something like that? But there it is. So I wanted to show you that you could wind up with one of these libraries. Beatrice wound up with one that cost $20,000 plus $2,000 for furnishings, which was a lot of money in 1902, and there's very little paperwork to show for it. A lot of people don't realize there actually were requirements and seem to think, especially a lot of officials after the fact, that somebody just simply sent out an SOS saying we need a library and one came to them, but it wasn't that simple. First of all, there was supposed to be a public library board organized according to state law. And for some places, I believe, for example, Hastings is an example of that, where when they found out there was this opportunity, they got out there and got organized and developed a library board. So there's examples of places where the actual existence of the library, as we know it, is because of Carnegie and the gift and the fact that the community saw this as a way to move forward and show how progressive they were and, of course, get a building out of the deal. But this is the part that many people do not realize. The community had to provide the site, but it couldn't be just any site. It was supposed to be convenient, so you didn't put it out on the edge of town. And it had to have natural light all around the building. And we will see at least one exception I can think of in Nebraska that has always surprised me that they managed to do that. And there was also supposed to be room to expand for the future. And some of us, like Beatrice, will tell you that became a real issue in the future. And again, because there was not a lot of, in fact, once they got these buildings, it's hard to tell that there was much supervision at all. And so things happened in the future without anyone from the Carnegie Foundation or from representing Mr. Carnegie intervening and saying, wait a minute, I warned you about that. Now we'll make you sorry. Tentative building plans had to be approved by Carnegie, which was actually by his secretary. And this got to be a big issue. Again, I'll tell you about Beatrice because I know that story inside out. But we actually have a building that was built so early that there was not a standard form in terms of the architecture, as you'd see later on. And many of the later libraries in in Nebraska were built under a very standard plan. And as a result, we not only had a double stairway, a stairway outside and then a large stairway inside, but it just went right up to the main floor. There was nothing at the entrance that went to the basement, to the lower level. Instead, once you got up to the top floor, then there were two side stairs, one in each reading room on either side, just a narrow little stairway that took you back down to the basement. So in other words, you had to go up to go down. And
not confusing at all.
Not at all. And they were actually intended to be the up and down staircase. One side would be up and one would be down. Well, later on, Carnegie criticized, when they were complaining they didn't have enough room, they really criticized them over the fact that they had all these stairways. And locally, the school board, believe it or not, in Beatrice, was supervising and overseeing the public library plans, and they thought that was way too many stairways too, so they just took out one of those narrow ones, which meant that in the future, for the next 80 some years that was used as a library, two people could hardly pass each other on that stairway, interior stairway, from the first floor to the basement. The funding source had to be public, and they had to agree to a basic funding level that would be maintained by them, and that was 10% of the amount that was received as a grant. So for example, again, I'll just use Beatrice, because they got $20,000 for the building, they made a promise that in perpetuity they would fund the library at the grand amount of $2,000.
Wow.
So we have this $2,000 commitment that we've made forever and ever. And they did have to, continue, they had to agree to a continuous existence of the public library in the community. So to whatever extent they could at the time, they tried to guarantee that the library would be in that building and not have someone else move in and take it over, like I said, as the city hall, for example, mm-hmm. and that they would have some basic, very basic level of funding, and that it would go on and on, that they wouldn't do it just long enough to get the building and then close the library and use it for something
right.
else.
But as we were talking before we started, that and we all know in many towns that the library is actually no longer in that original Carnegie building.
That's
because
correct.
Of like the ADA or expansion needs, whatever. So it's interesting that requirement didn't say in this building.
That's right.
You just said in the community you must still have a public library. If this you outgrow this building or you decide you're going to build something else, that's okay.
It was from Carnegie. And of course, it was hard for anybody to imagine any of that at the time because
yeah.
they were just so in awe of what they were getting right at that moment. All of the things I can think of that became problems were that back to that land requirement. A lot of times, the way that people acquired the land, someone gave it to them, and they might have given it to them with a deed restriction that said, this has to be used as the library,
mm-hmm.
and even come up with something, what would happen if it wasn't, that it would revert to the owner, that it would, whatever other stipulation they put in. And that became very painful in some communities because the city or some other entity did not want to give up that land. It was in a crucial location,
yeah.
and yet they couldn't really do anything but have the library because that was tied into the whole way that the land was acquired in the first place. So the problem locations that I'm aware of in terms of someone saying, oh, this always has to be the library, it's actually not Carnegie, it's the land and the stipulations
mm-hmm.
that were put on it when that land was given or deeded or sold or whatever arrangement was made for it. From now on, what we're going to see are photos of Carnegie buildings in Nebraska. Now, there were 69 of these built, which is a pretty nice number. The newer part of the country really benefited because, again, many of our communities didn't have libraries, and the time of these Carnegie grants was a time when many towns were, in the case of someone like Scotts Bluff being founded, because they founded in 1900, or in the case of many of our other communities, they were really developing and moving past the earliest years, moving into being really settled towns, not just little frontier settlements. The very first one we have here in Nebraska, which you can see is dated 1901, was built in a crisis situation. Lincoln's library burned. And so, yes, oh, and it was actually built, located in the Masonic Temple on O Street, just north of where Bennett Martin is now. And when that, and that library, I mean, it just burned. It, everything was gone. And so they desperately needed a library, and obviously we're on a real fast track where the Carnegie came. And some of us are still can still remember this. It, for those of you trying to figure it out, yes, it was located where Bennett Martin Public Library is located now, and it actually sits on the corner in the same way. It faces west, as do the front doors of Bennett Martin Public Library. It was a beautiful, impressive building. I'm extremely sentimental about architecture. And although that, again, that was a prime spot. You can see it was built early enough that there, in the background you can see a house instead of the YWCA or any other building like that. But these buildings, again, you heard me talk about the bad. They really outgrew their usefulness. It was hard for them to keep up with modern times and just the size of them. Ordinarily, even though they look massive and really impressive, they quickly, if the town was growing at all, it would quickly outstrip the size of these buildings. This is the second one in Fremont, and it is also gone. You notice it's dated 1903, has lovely name right over the front door, so you have no doubts about it. An interesting architectural style. That front door really isn't the usual styling that you see anymore with that beautiful arch. Something about Carnegie, he did not insist that his name be put on it, and in fact, he really did not. For somebody who wanted the good publicity of it, he wasn't insisting that these be called after him, although some communities did. Pawnee City had a Carnegie Library for years that they called the Carnegie Library. But what he did say, if they were going to put anything up to impress him, he would say that he'd like to have had something that looked like the Torch of Knowledge, something that represented light. So we'll have to watch for those. This is also a building, as I, if I haven't mentioned before, that is gone. One of the things that's interesting about this, now keep in mind, this is the second one built in the state. Notice in the background, it looks like it's coming right up against another building. And again, for something to be that early and already be breaking his rules. But there you notice the classic steps right up to the front, all those steps, and you know inside, it's probably going to be another set of steps. Notice though that the whole way that the basement is actually has full-size windows, and that's also partly, of course, the whole reason everyone's having to climb to get to the first floor, that the lower levels on the in these buildings were well lit. Now, for those of you thinking, well, how nice that was for children, Andrew Carnegie did not have a soft spot in his heart for children. Children's services were actually developing in a parallel mode, beginning with settlement houses and the need to bring immigrant children into the American mainstream through cultural things like nursery rhymes, stories, the things that we all accept and use as the, kind of the basis of our culture with when we're young. They needed to know those stories and hear those stories, and that evolved into a larger children's services. When Andrew Carnegie had these buildings designed, that lower level was ordinarily an auditorium room, meeting, our idea of a meeting room. Mm-hmm. This comes out of the time of things like the Lyceum movement, Chautauqua, all of that time period where people lectured. And so the idea was you could go downstairs and hear a lecture and go upstairs and check out books about that topic. So there was a real sense, almost a community college sort of sense, which fits also because, of course, Andrew Carnegie was part of that idea of the People's University. Mm-hmm. And the other idea about these buildings is they were to be, look as impressive as a building would look on a college campus. This is the one that I know best, which is the Beatrice Public Library. And it opened in January 1904 because the furniture didn't get there in time. They were in a contest to try to get to be one of the earliest. And so they were disappointed that they weren't able to beat out Fremont, but they were thrilled that they beat out Grand Island, because that was the big challenge. Now, because I know this building, I will point out some things about it. Number one is that the top, that you're the very, very top of the building that you're looking at above those arched windows, that is a four-foot parapet. There is no building up there. And I say that because I was completely fooled and went through an entire interview in Beatrice believing that there was a basement, a first floor, and a second floor in that building. There was a basement and a first floor. And so I wanted to have a redo of the interview when I realized that there was only two-thirds of the space that I thought that they had in that building. This one does not look like others. It was built based upon buildings from the Trans-Mississippi Exposition of 1898 in Omaha, which was the World's Fair. And again, this is early enough that Carnegie hadn't quite gotten a hold of the process and or his secretary and said, you must do things in this one particular way. So this building got by with some things. You can't see it from here, but the core of the building, the center, is an octagon, not a rectangle. So the whole building was built, and it meant that all of the shelving went, it was a pie shape, one long, one short segment. Believe me, you can hardly come up with any more inefficient way to lay out a library. Oh, this is a photo that we found at the State Historical Society of the Interior. What you're looking across at, I just love to point this out, this is the children's, the first time they had a children's area. And you look at it and think, how could that be the children's area? The tables were 2 inches shorter than the adult. But in this building, it was the first time that children under 12 were allowed to check out books, which, again, when you go back and look at some of your early library starts, you may be surprised to realize that their idea was that library service started at age 12. I won't go on and on about this, I promise. We'll just move right on. Hastings came right along next. And here, remember that newspaper or that magazine cover I had? Here you've got, this is just classic. Yes. The columns, the triangular pediment over the front door. This just, it absolutely is a classic. And you notice there, we don't have the flame. We have an open book. Mm-hmm. Oh, by the way, that is also the location of the present Carnegie, or non-Carnegie Library. Grand Islands, and there's still survives. Pink marble inside, that's what I remember about it. This is who Beatrice was in such competition. They were so afraid Grand Island was going to get ahead of them. Of course, Grand Island then managed to get the president get Teddy Roosevelt there for the groundbreaking. So even though they had to wait a little bit more, they really topped every effort that Beatrice had made in terms of their library. But again, we have a very classic design here. Again, one that, even though it's, well, on one side you can see that it's very close to buildings. Mm-hmm. Carney, and here I've been trying to figure out what that, I don't think even yet we've got a light or a torch.
We've got shield shape or something.
Yeah, we've got something. But don't forget this one. By this time, there's some other interesting things happening. Look at the length of those windows on that upper floor. Of course, we still have the lower one, but the windows are not nearly as large as what we're used to seeing. And you notice the steps aren't quite as steep. We also, here you're going to see a tile roof. So, yeah, again, different architectural things. We've got a lot of things that are very classic, but they're also starting to pick up on some of the new exciting new trends in what is going on in architecture at the time. And there we get a wonderful view of the interior of the Kearney Public Library with books and tables and chairs. And those were, again, very classic. It wouldn't surprise me at all. The furniture in Beatrice was Library Bureau, you know, Melville Dewey's company. And this furniture also looks very, very similar to that. The Carnegie grants, as I mentioned, Beatrice got $2,000 for furniture, and I don't know what the budget was for Kearney, but it wasn't just the building. You actually did have money for furniture, and the idea was that you were going to buy quality furniture. Mm-hmm. Some of us still have some of that furniture in our buildings. I always say that whenever anybody's pushing on about how thrifty they are in the city of Beatrice, I point out we are still using things that go back to the Carnegie over 100 years ago. Oh, there's the children's area. And again, notice how high those tables are. The concept of children is still not our idea when you think about our strengths. And the first we had, of course, the preschoolers were just how important they were to us for years. And now with the various LAPSIT programs, when we think about children right from the beginning.
Right.
Here's one of the Lincoln. This is the Lincoln's second opportunity in Havelock in Northeast Lincoln. And of course, Havelock used to be a standalone town, but now it counts as part of the many. Lincoln is the champion at getting Carnegie buildings. Again, look at those beautiful arch. There you've got an arched window that is so large. You have six divisions in it. Again, classic columns, the triangular pediment at the top, and we're back to the larger windows on the lower level. Again, if you've been to Havelock lately, you know that in these years, there really was empty space around some of these buildings. Pawnee City, this is the one. If you notice that they actually are calling themselves the Carnegie Public Library, there, yeah. And they have only recently moved into a new library in just
that's
the last
right, they did,
years.
Yeah.
Yes. And again, part of the challenge, this is kind of part of the bad, is once you have these buildings and you have this thing labeled public library, in many communities the perception is this has got to be the library. There can't be anything else but the library. This was kind of interesting because you notice the lower level, the base of this, has rusticated stone. It's not the smooth stone that we normally see in those. Also, the side, if you notice there, we've got a little pitch to that roof. So here you have both that classic kind of temple look at the front, but they managed to work in a little pitch to the roof, kind of on the order of what we had seen with the Carney Library. Tecumseh is another one. Now here we're starting to see some different architectural elements. We still have kind of a classic facade, although we no longer have the columns as we saw them before with the round columns. Now everything is just much more squared and much more rectangular. In fact, we're kind of heading, but look at the drawing they have there, 1907. The building looks much more modern than that woman in her outfit yeah. does. And here we also don't have a flat roof. Take a look at that roof. So that you have some opportunities perhaps for drainage in different ways than some of us can tell you about those original ones. And here, the lower level, again, look at how decorative the windows were, where it's really highlighting those and not trying to just act like, oh, don't
all
look down.
All the little things.
Yeah. There's wonderful features in these buildings. If you get ready to build a new building like that, the lines that you see on the front at the corners, actually everywhere, that's called coining, Q-U-O-I-N, ING, and that is very expensive. When we built the new building in Beatrice, we could only afford to do that on the corners to kind of fake out that we really had that division. Then we just changed brick color to give the effect otherwise, because it's very, every time you change angle or anything with a brick, it costs money. Here we have Albion, again, back to the classic look, and now they're starting to incorporate more light features in with these buildings as well. This one also, if you notice I don't know which direction that building sits, but we're looking at the front. If you look on the side, you'll see that there they were actually able to repeat the pediment effect on that side. And I don't know if it did on the other, but the symmetry of the building would make you think that. Again, that was a lot of money got spent on these facades. They really were not plain, simple buildings. And here again, we have a chance to take a look at Albion inside, and you notice that really sturdy oak furniture.
Oh, yeah. Gorgeous desk.
Yeah. The librarian keeping an eye on everybody. I love this one. I love McCook so much. I love the whole town's look, which this matched, of Spanish colonial revival. And I love the story behind it, as I understand. And if anybody from McCook hears this and I've got this wrong, don't hesitate to get in touch and correct me. But I was there with a Main Street activity and was told that a spur was found out in the country near McCook, and it was believed to be from a Spanish conquistador, one of those guys looking for Quivira and the lost cities of gold. And so McCook felt, as their heritage, that they should claim that Spanish look. So keep in mind what we've seen so far, how classic everything was. And when McCook built their Carnegie, they were allowed to incorporate this look that they were building all over in downtown McCook, of having this allusion to a Spanish past. Mm-hmm. So there we have a Carnegie. It's one of the most unusual Carnegies in Nebraska.
It's nice that they let them do that, that they didn't say, no, you have to look like all the other ones.
Right,
they
right.
have to pay attention to and make it personal.
Yes, I absolutely, I just absolutely love that.
Yeah, and we have a comment from the audience, Manya Shore, who I know was just recently living out in California, says that it looks like California to me. It reminds me of California.
Right, yeah, that's why I was calling it Spanish mm-hmm. Colonial Revival, because that the Spanish colony is, of course, California, all of that, the Southwest, and of course, some people call it mission style, but anyway, here it is, complete with, and I will point out, tile roofs and the tile awning. So that's just one of my super favorites. And there you can see it right from the front. Here it almost looks like a cute little house. Mm-hmm. There's all those steps. Even though they did all the other things, we're still walking up, symbolically walking up to knowledge. Fairbury is another classic. And if you look at that, you'll realize it's very, very similar to the one that we saw back in Kearney. In fact, look at the front with that. What are we seeing there? Look, I've got to, Fairbury's close enough. I've got to go over and study just exactly what the front looks like. But again, clean lines. And this building has been added on to today, so it is still in use. And now we're seeing another Lincoln opportunity. This is the Northeast Branch. I took children to this. I babysat one year when I was living in Lincoln in the summer and took kids over. And so I have to tell you that I had the thrill of taking children in. Then the rule in Lincoln was you had to write your own name. And I taught the five-year-old to print her name so she'd get her own card before we went over there. You talk about rote. Just don't worry about what these mean. Just make these letters. But and that one's the one that's now been moved. And Matt Talbot is using that. So that building has continued to have a functional life. One of the things that has been commented when I've done this program for the public, how massive these buildings look unless they pull back and give them some perspective. And again, if you look at the house next door, another building, you suddenly realize, wow, there's a lot going on in a relatively small amount of space. Superior. And now we're seeing a different style, but one, and again, there we see a church, and you see the size of the church and then the size of that building. Here we're seeing a gabled effect. In fact, it's a style we think of somewhat European. Sometimes you have those kind of stepped gables. And again, that's another style that I've seen in Carnegie's, I've seen Iowa, just all over the country, where you no longer have that classic Greek temple look, and yet you still have, you know, really clean lines, is a serious building, one that in the community says this is an important building, this building has credibility, and so does whatever is going on inside. And there's the interior of that particular one, and I happen to know that they were looking at that when they were doing their new, because they also have a new library. And it is hard in this day and time, it is hard to equal the just the significance, just the architectural integrity of some of these old buildings. It's a real challenge when you are trying to build a new building. Here's Sutton. Now here we've gone to a whole different way. We're no longer, even though they're paying a little bit of tribute there to that column idea on either side, but now we are really into the world of the prairie style and just much simpler building style, and we'll see that again and again in Nebraska. I think it appealed to people both because now this really looked modern. When you think about what that Beatrice Library looked like with all of the frills and the Corinthian columns, we're a long ways from that. So, you know, you're building a new, clean looking, in terms of the lines and the style, building. It's saying a lot about how up to date your town is. And again, these are efficient buildings. They bring in a lot of light. There's not a lot of extra maintenance on them. And again, we've got those wonderful, look on the side of that and you'll see how big those windows are. Here's Alma, and they have an interesting variation. We have what we've seen before, just recently with the gabled ends, but here we've got the curved, remember all those arched windows we started out with?
It's kind of a mixture of different styles.
You can just see that they kind of did a pick and choose of things that they liked. And we haven't seen this too much yet, but we will before long. It's very possible that we're starting to see libraries that are built based upon libraries they've seen elsewhere, because by now we've got enough Carnegies out there that people are seeing them and are picking up designs and design features they're seeing somewhere else. And that's a shortcut with Andrew Carnegie's secretary. If you can be submitting a design that's already gone for someone else. We're also in 1911, this is where Mr. Bertram comes up with a standard plan. And so from here on, these libraries are being sent plans, at least for the floor plan, that is a standard, there's a standard look to Carnegie's from now on that most people think was always there and are surprised by some of the variations they see in the early ones. Here's Ashland again. They've gone back to that the classic look. But look at those windows. Now we've got, I believe those are divided into nine mm-hmm. on those front windows. So we've lost the arch. The arch is just in the doorway now. But when you think about all the natural light that poured into those buildings, when you think about how inadequate the lighting was otherwise, why it's not a bad thing at all. Aurora, look at this one. We're talking about, I don't know about California, maybe, I know it, like I said, to me, it is so prairie. It is, it's just, it's got the offset front door. And if you notice, we don't really have a column, but we have a feature there on either side of the front door that still, what it says is you are arriving somewhere that's significant. This is an important place. And I was looking, and although this is taken at the angle, symmetry is so important in Carnegie buildings. Normally, the right side matches the left side. You don't see a lot of odd, unusual architecture. By the way, the tile roof is back, if you hadn't noticed. And this is another one of those buildings that's deceptive. I just doubt very much there's a third floor, but you look at that, and it looks like there ought to be. Chadron, now we've moved to the panhandle, and again, look at this looks so simple. This, I mean, a lot of people probably look at this and say, what a simple building, till you start looking at all the brick features that are used on that building. Again, we've got the arch back. We're not spending money on extra arched windows, but look at that front door. And, of course, we don't have the columns, and we don't have as many steps, bless their hearts. I know, lucky people. It means their lower level didn't have as big a windows, but they sure didn't have the issues to get people in and out of there that some of the others did.
There appears to be fewer windows in the front. Not as almost end-to-end as there was
in
the other ones.
Right, right. And then you see the windows on the side. And again, they're not as large a window. They don't extend down, but keep in mind that means people have places for the shelving.
Right.
Remember, as we were talking about, that these were not designed, especially initially, by library people at all. That's a beautiful building in its simplicity, because there's actually wonderful textured details going on with that, but you don't see all of the extra things that we do. Here's Neely, and another one that's kind of taken advantage, I think, of what they've seen other people do. So again, we've got that the front entrance that's pulled out a little bit from the building itself. A pitched roof, so we're not going to have some of the flat roof issues that some of the others did. Large windows, and those large windows repeat on the sides of the building as well as the front. And here, again, we're back to the high steps, so that if you look at the lower level windows there, they're going to get a lot of light. And they're also still using lighting, as we saw before, as one of the architectural features of that building. Again, very beautiful. The top looks like something that you call dentaling, which is actually based on the same word as our teeth come from, where you have those. And again, it's just for a building that might look simple to people, it has a lot of detailing. Look at that chimney also. That's really an attractive chimney. That's 1911. So you can see that this is also the same year. It's a big year there's been a lot of buildings. And a lot of different styles. And remember that they are getting instructions by now from Carnegie about just how they're supposed to be built. Here's Norfolk. Again, they've gone back, got that pitched roof, the kind of thing that we just saw over at Neely, got coining, but they're only doing it at the corners. But we've got that sense of a real, the pediment, the old classic entrance. Mm-hmm. Schuyler. Here we've got one. Remember that gable that we had before on the end? Now it's pulled around to the front, and look at that entrance. Again, entrance is important if any of you ever dealt with, both to get people in, and also you can set the tone of how they feel about the place. Like I said, it's out of breath, perhaps, with the stairways, but also say, and it's also important to know where you get into the building. And this is just, they did a wonderful job with that. Again, look at the size of the windows on that lower level. Alliance, and we're seeing this from the side. Again, we've got there big columns.
Giant columns, yeah.
When you look at the texture of the building, all of that coining I was talking about, again, very significant. The kind of building that some of these could passport. There's churches that have that kind of Greek temple style. And you look at some of these, and like I said, these buildings, they were making a statement about the community. One part about this that wasn't really emphasized, but the community's viability was really important. And having a Carnegie building come was saying that Andrew Carnegie believed your town had a future. And again, we're at a time when after the Panic of 1893 and the crop failure through 1896, a lot of our towns just came to screeching halts by the end of the 19th century. And so a lot of them were kind of reinventing themselves and picking themselves up, or in the case of some of the communities in the Panhandle, they were really just getting started.
There's a comment about the Neely Library from Laura Hess, who's at Stanton Public Library now. She used to live in Neely for 20 years. She says the library has been made into a home now.
Oh.
And there's a beautiful fireplace in it.
Yes. Well, thank you. Anybody who has anything to share about what they know, it's much appreciated. Geneva is another one that has a wonderful practical building. Again, with a lot of styling, you get that sense of prairie style with it. And this is one, again, that's been added onto, and added onto beautifully in a way that really honors the original architecture and at the same time opens up the building to be what it needs to be today to help. Again, now you notice the lights aren't as fancy, but we're still using a light, and we still have that entrance that is significant and pulled away from the building so that you walk into something before you enter the building itself. Of course, some of us know you're really just resting before you get to the next set of stairs. North Bend. And here's one again that's gone back to classic styling with the triangular pediment over the front door. We no longer have columns. Instead, we have that interesting decorative brickwork on either side. And a lot of steps going up, which the steps allow us to have those wonderful windows for the lower level. Also, underneath the windows, there's some decorative detailing. We haven't seen anything like that before. Very, very interesting building. One of the things that was pointed out when I was showing this to just general public people is if you don't have something in the background, or in this case, we've got some trees, these buildings all look so massive. Mm-hmm. The way that they are built and the proportions they use, whether it's small or large, they are just an impressive looking building, and it's often shocking to realize how small they are. You know, you're just talking about the one in Neely being able to be used for a home, and when you see some of these without any context, they look like they'd just be gigantic. And here's North Platte, and again, now you can kind of get that sense of, oh, if you see these buildings alone, sometimes you think, that's the Carnegie. When you realize that, for example, the gable style has been used elsewhere, this one's interesting because the entrance is also gabled. Mm-hmm. So you don't just have that on the ends. You have, which almost gives it a religious, usually when you see these kind of things, a lot of times that peak is something you see on a church. But there you've got remember our old favorite arch that we saw so often at the beginning? You've got an arch door, and again, a sense of the columns on the side. Here we don't have quite as high of steps, so if you notice, the windows aren't as big over there. But these buildings were wonderful to bring in light. And again, we've got that complete, even though it's a town that was as large as North Platte was and is, you have the opening all the way around it, so you don't have buildings just built at this point right up next to it. But some of this is kind of similar. Look at how many lights it took to adequately light the interior of a library.
Even with all those windows.
Even with all the windows, yeah. And there we got our classic furniture again, classic oak furniture. Here's O'Neill. Again, another building that really gives you a sense of kind of the prairie style. It's not a building full of a lot of elaborate extra details, and yet look at how the light and dark, even as dark as this photograph is, how striking that building is. And again, we've got an attractive tile roof, and we've got somebody out in front. At least she's real, a real person, and she's not dressed as in such an old-fashioned way. Look at all those trees that they were planting too. One of the things I'll say about Carnegie's is that they were either using awnings or having plantings to cool the building and to shade it and to keep, sometimes there was almost too much light coming in there. Back to the classic, Pierce 1912, wonderful looking building. It's another one where the the stone on the lower level is that kind that we talked about is rusticated. And a lot of times when you see those windows that have the divisions in just almost the sunburst manner, a lot of that you see in places like San Francisco's full of that after the earthquake of 1906. So it's a style from that period, not one we often see a lot in Nebraska, period, and certainly not. Here's one where they're actually using it in a double way, a very decorative way at the Pierce Library. Also on the side, notice here that our front windows are not as significant as the ones on the side. Mm-hmm. So that, again, there's just interesting variations people were able to do to make these buildings special to them and to work for them and the place that they're being built. Ponca. This does not do Ponca justice because Ponca's library is up a huge hill. And it's kind of interesting when they talk about accessible and the space around it. I have to say, this is the first library I ever used. My dad had a job in Ponca, and so I was allowed to go to story time here before I was 3 years old. Those of you who know me know I'm very short, and the big challenge was you had to sit on a chair, and it wasn't that I couldn't sit quietly. It was getting me up on that chair because I had to be able to get up on it all by myself. So I'm very fond of Ponca. Again, arched door. Very simple in the sense that we don't really have the columns on either side. What they did is picked up the look of the column all the way around the building. Yeah. And again, nice windows. And here we don't see so many steps, but keep in mind it's taken a while to get up to the Ponca Library. And then here's a later one where you can see that there's just been more work done around the library. So we have more steps. Remember what I was saying about steps? I think Ponca wins for steps. Because that when you have a library up a hill and you have to climb the steps to get there, they take the cake, I think. Gibbon. Now, keep in mind what we just saw there. Look at Gibbon. This one's interesting because of, look what happened in the middle. We never had anything like this before where in Nebraska, where we've had the windows down, but inside, look at all that space they created, probably for shelving. And then the windows are higher. And there again, yeah. Gibbon is claiming the name, the Carnegie Public Library. And we have some other features that we talked about. The lighting is a major feature here. The building is very plain, but then look at that entrance. We got a little partial arch. We've actually got some kind of parapet effect on, you know, kind of castellated looking thing there. And we've got those fancy lights. So They weren't content to just go quietly. They wanted to do something that made it a little fancier than usual. Madison, I love what they did. They went back, grabbed that arch, grabbed that triangular pediment, but they took advantage of a pitched roof, and they have impressive front windows. But look at the sides. You can look right there and say, there's the shelves with the windows above them.
Finally taking into account what the building is used for.
Yeah. Wayne. Now, what I like about Wayne, remember what I said about symmetry?
It's not.
That's right. Wayne said, we're doing it our way. You know what? We can do this so the door is over here, and then we just put all those windows together. Again, if you look at this initially and think it's a simple window, just start a simple building, start looking at those windows and all of the brick work and the effort that went there, and even in between the division between the upper and lower floors is not just that simple concrete band that we've often seen with these buildings. I just get very tickled looking at what people did. Here we've got it looks like the tile roof again, but people, when they did these designs, they really did attempt to bring, McCook was the one that allows us to see it the most dramatically, but they really did attempt to bring the special features to it. Here's Wayne at a later date. Burwell. And Burwell, again, looks pretty plain. You know, it's kind of rectangular box. Then start looking at that brickwork. And again,
all that detail. Yeah.
Some bricklayer up there spent a lot of time doing that. Like I said, today, if you said to someone, you know, we'd like to copy the effect of the Burwell, Bell Public Library, they would kind of gasp before they told you what you just added to your cost. And there again, we have that effect of the columns on each side. Here we've got a little peak instead of an arch, and they are again claiming the Carnegie name. Look at their stairway too. Talk about stair steps. The sides of it are stair stepped as the stairs themselves, which is again another interesting effect, and one that just adds a little decorative feature to, like you said, a building that's really on the surface looks very simple. Fairfield. Now they don't look simple when you get there. You've got the decorative windows above the front door. We've got those brackets as part of the design element. Oh, and we also have the fancy windows above. We've got an entrance that comes right out to greet you, which actually is something you want. You want that feeling. Mm-hmm. They want me to come in there. And we don't have as many steps, bless their hearts. And we've got a roof that's no longer, they're taking advantage of those roofs no longer having to be flat. And we've worked our way up to 1914. Seward. Now, Seward is the exception to a lot of things, and one of them is, remember that rule about access? And I have to think it's because they were putting it in the town square, and that which is so crucial in Seward, that they were either they weren't paying attention to the rules anymore, or they got into an exception. Because if you notice, they are just sandwiched in there. Or they built those buildings smack dab against them afterwards, and nobody complaint, because as I said, the people who were watching these things didn't. like I said, a lot of this stuff happened. Again, with Seward, you can see that there's space there for shelves, that the windows don't go down as far. But we've still got, even though we're looking at this at a distance, we've still got columns, and we've got a strong sense of where you enter the building. Shelton. And this looks somewhat familiar, although if you notice, none of them are the same. Are really the exactly the same. We had that Fairbury Kearney thing way back when. They're another one. They took a page from Wayne and said, we don't have to have the door right in the center. But they also, again, that sense of what is this building for? So you have light coming in, but you can see that would be light coming in above the shelves because they're no longer making those great big huge decorative windows and then trying to fit the shelving in around it. Columbus. This is another one that still retained the lighting feature. In fact, that's one of the really important things about that building that you notice right away. Mm-hmm. They've attempted to both pick up on the classic, and we're back to the symmetry, but we don't have a lot of elaborate columns. We don't have a lot of extra features that are going to be just one more maintenance headache or one more expense as you're building. Wonderful large windows. Again, the count on those big ones is 9 panes. And they're just calling themselves the public library. But again, for some of you who've ever lived with that, even putting that up there in stone, boy, that can make it hard to move on. And here's Crete. Crete, again, that dentaling feature I was talking about before, that's part of what you're seeing at the very top there. And they used it again at their entrance. They, again, used that light feature. And we've also got nice-sized windows on the lower level as well as the ones upstairs. Now, here you can see a little bit of both. Because you can see that we've got, on the side, you can see that we've got long windows. And then the higher windows, again, are where you have shelving. So you get a sense. The other thing that's interesting about Crete is the way that center goes. Normally, when you see that, it means that there's some kind of feature inside. You couldn't see it so much in Beatrice, but they actually have a rotunda inside. Yeah. And so often, when you'd walk in, there would be something inside that would be some kind of an architectural feature that would be kind of a surprise. When you got outside, it looked like one kind of building, and you walked in, and there was a lot more room, or there was a skylight, or there was something special about it. Franklin, they did a couple of things. They did asymmetry, but they look at that, the classic entrance to it. And then, again, the arch. And I know that this is also a building where Crete, I should have said, was added on to. Franklin, I know, moved into another building. But there, again, sometimes you want the best of both worlds. You want to have that effect of the classic, but at the same time, trying to build a practical building. And here's Stanton, and this is looking familiar. This is another one where I think if you think back, there's design elements where we think, we've seen this before. We've seen the front that's simpler. We've seen the windows around with the decorative features. We've seen the bracketing on the roof.
Yeah, Laura Hess is on watching now from Stanton.
Oh, great.
She had mentioned earlier that when you showed Geneva, it looked very similar to the Stanton one.
Yes.
The 1915 one. And they're still using theirs.
That's good.
Still where the library's at.
And how's that working out? Because to be in these buildings, you do make compromises. Now,
yes.
They aren't as crazy as what went on with Beatrice, but I will mention that building had a marble floor. I mean, real chunks of marble that when we were first putting in computers, which, yes, I'm so old, I can remember when we first put in computers, they couldn't figure out where the wires went. It turned out there's a subfloor built underneath to hold up the marble floor. I missed that day. You know how directors leave when things get like that? And so I left that day, and when I came back, the staff before me, they had never heard so much swearing for 8 hours consistently over these guys trying to run that electrical wires. This library, I just love. Look at the size or the lack of size of it. And yet it is such, I mean, it's a wonderful little building, but it's really small. And if they had taken a close-up of that, we would not have any idea that it really is not that large a building. Again, they did the asymmetrical entrance, although they went back and picked up the arch, as well as wonderful windows, but these are different yet, because if you notice just the way that they're set up, you have a smaller pane at the top, but not surprising, considering that it's not that big a building. But again, they still have that lower level. Now, you know, all of you know by now, these people, everybody's got their children's room more than likely moved down to that lower level. It's no longer the auditoriums, but they're still doing that. Carnegie's still approving that upstairs, downstairs effect.
Laura does say that at Stanton, they don't have that many steps on the outside now,
oh,
but
good.
They have them on the inside.
Trouble.
Still dealing with that.
Here's Broken Bow. Again, wonderful. After a while, when I was doing these, looking at these, I just started falling in love with these features, and I wanted to list, here's all the ones that have the side gables. Oh, here's all the ones that have lighting at the front instead of either with the columns or instead of columns. And here we have a really interesting window effect, where you have, because of the banding right in the middle of it, it's almost like two windows into one. Really fascinating building. And again, I just get the sense that some of these people just had a wonderful time going around visiting or looking at plans from other towns and other libraries.
To pick what they wanted.
Right,
to have it
right.
Theirs, yeah.
And that's a newspaper clipping. We'll move on because we had a better pick. This is, we're back, one more Lincoln one from 1916. This is College View, of course, is right on the edge of Union College campus. And some people used to be where the public radio station was. But again, here we just, well, first of all, look at all those steps again. And we're right back where columns, pediments, although the basic building itself isn't as elaborate and fancy when you look at it as some, but boy, they have an entrance. But again, it's consistent with those other Lincoln ones. So I think they were building, they had a certain look that they
trying
had that they
the
repeated.
The
right.
It's going to be anywhere
right.
near the city, in the city, yeah.
Gothenburg, and again, they have, this is a real departure. We have an L-shaped building with a little entrance right there in the middle of the L, and we have a gabled effect. It's really different. Again, almost has a church-like effect if you stuck a steeple on it, because and again, they were allowed to make this departure. And I find that very interesting because, like I said, by this time, the Carnegie people really had this down to a science. Here's the plan. Do it our way. And these people didn't spend a whole lot of money on any part of this, you know, to show something. But look at what they did with their windows. They did some extra features and detailing on those windows, right. And again, the one thing they did is also that light feature. They have those light globes there on either side of the door, because we're not seeing columns anymore, any of the things that we have seen over and over again on this. And keep in mind, this is the same year we're seeing this built as that the classic one that we just saw from Lincoln. Hardington, out here we've got, oh, this one, like I said, it looks like Frank Lloyd Wright stood and looked over somebody's shoulder to try to make that just be a really classic prairie type of building. And yet, again, look at the window treatments, little extra touches there. And that side entrance.
Side door, yeah, yes. I'm looking at that at the awning there.
And I'm wondering if they are another one, we talked about this not being a symmetrical building, if we have an entrance to the upstairs, if we have an entrance over there to the downstairs, and how they mesh together. If anybody knows how that worked in Hardington, I would be interested to see that. But again, it's just one of those little things you don't notice, the border that changes from one floor to the other that goes around. If you notice, it's almost like a double one. It's got extra dimension to it beyond what you'd normally expect. I am curious, too, if anybody knows what color Hardington is, I'd love to know that. It's just such an interesting building, and you notice the even in this photo, we can see that the bricks change color. Harvard, I mean, I love it. It could be the bank. It could be all kinds of things, but again, like I said, we're getting to the end of the program, and look at this. Hardington is right next door to another building, just
right there,
yes. But they really went all out. We are back to arched windows, folks. We're back to columns. We're back to a lot of that look that we haven't seen since the turn of the century. And here it is. It's like somebody there said, we're going to do this the way I saw when I liked we're building a classic building, because it is. It's full of classical architectural features. All those arches, yeah. It still has big windows, but they managed to do that, even though there's not that many steps on the outside, but probably somebody there would be calling to say, but wait till you get inside.
Laura, again, she knows a lot about these libraries. I guess it says Hardington, the previous one, has an addition now, and the old main floor is an art gallery.
Oh, thank you for telling me that. Yeah. I have to say, this does make me want to go out and visit even more.
Actually see them in person, yeah.
Plainview, asymmetrical. Again, they borrowed from here and there, as you can see. And this one actually reminds me of schools. I have seen schools that are very, the windows are so plain. In fact, the big decorative feature is at the entrance. And I wish I could, I think it just says library.
Yeah,
I don't think they worried about public, Carnegie, or Plainview, or anybody else. Mm-hmm. I, as somebody who's dealt with really awful flat roofs, I really admire that roof. That roof looks really sensible to me.
Here where we've got the snow coming, you need that kind of thing, yes.
And this is another one where we've got, in this asymmetrical building style, we've got that side entrance.
Side door again, yeah.
So anybody who knows anything about where they're leading or how that's working, I'd like to know. Here's Takema. Takema knew how to use plants to great effect on this one. Again, you can see we're back to that classic prairie style with the bracketing and the relatively plain windows, but wonderful. They have to be wonderful in terms of letting in light. However, again, here we've got that issue. Where are those stacks? Because I assume they're along the sides. It's hard to see the sides in the back of the building. University Place. And by now you know there's a look to these Lincoln libraries. And, of course, University Place also used to be its own town. For those of you who aren't Methodists, University Place is where Wesleyan is. And, again, I still don't see at the top. I'm trying to figure out, we've got this wonderful swirl on that pediment, but I don't know that that's an actual light. The wonderful thing about a lot of these is they do lend themselves. When you see these, you can see why they become art galleries.
Yeah.
Why they become, there's a whole
Definitely
list.
Lend themselves
yes,
that, yes,
they really do. Arcadia, and then we seem to be dependent on a newspaper clipping here. But again, I think they've taken advantage of all of the classic features of those Carnegies. They thank goodness they got past the flat roofs, but they've got the triangular pediment, they've got the arched entrance, but they are not worrying it so much about some of those really elaborate window styles. And again, big windows, although on the side you can see where you have a little bit more chance again to get some shelving worked in there. Blair. Again, another building that's very similar. And again, you're looking at, we're starting to see these entrances on the side, even on the symmetrical buildings now. And that one's got a really pretty elaborate entrance as well. Really interesting combinations when you think about it, of these buildings using traditional architectural features. And then look at the windows, which would be the very modern looking windows for the time. No longer dealing with a lot of those elaborate arches. And Loop City. And again, it's like, yes, I've seen that one before. Didn't I just see that, where you can see that one is building and is using the ideas of another. Here, though, we have those side windows that are definitely letting them have enough room for the shelving underneath. And Sydney. And here we've got another look again. You know, again, this is a really positive thing for Sydney, for a town in the western part of the state where we haven't seen that many Carnegies. They did use the window treatment, but actually some part of this reminds me more of McCook than anything else, where you have that really elaborate curved detailed
I like the top.
Entrance.
Yes,
yes.
Very unique.
Right, right. Yeah. It is. And I have to say that Sydney is an interesting town architecturally, but I can't tell you say that there's that many other buildings that look anything like that. But it draws your attention to where you're supposed to walk into the building. And I believe this is used for their Chamber of Commerce now. Spencer. What can you say? This Spencer just... They do what they wanted to build, and they build it. They have room on the side. You can see from the side where the shelving is. There's not a lot of extra detail or but it looks like a very well-built brick building. And it's one of those, again, that Carnegie, they weren't building out of cheap materials. They were doing things the way that they're supposed to be done. I know that Beatrice, the bricks were brought in, I think, from Indiana. I'm not saying these people or anybody else are doing that, but I mean you were allowed to buy what you needed. If you needed a certain quality of brick, that's what you could get. And when you see something like this, this looks to me like, I don't know about Spencer, if anybody wants to tell me, I'd appreciate it, but it looks like a building that would stand them in good stead for some time. I say that because I know what the maintenance issues were from the building built in Beatrice. And here's Ravenna, again, really nice building. And when you see it without seeing a lot of, you know, we see little new trees, but it looks like a significant, substantial building. We've got that beautiful arch with all of the paned windows there that kind of match the ones overall. And again, remember that coining and all of the features. That building really has texture when you look at it. It also has some kind of elaborate roof design that I would love to say, oh, I know this is this or that or the other thing. I don't, but it looks like some real effort was spent in just the design of this building. A lot went into it. Clark's, again, asymmetrical building in the sense of where the entrance is, and yet they were able to use some really classic design elements. And again, parts of this remind me of some things you see in some residential homes with the brackets and the tile roof and just the way that they border the windows. And it just brings... They have design features in there that really, like I said, if you just drove by, you might think it's simple. And then you start looking at these buildings and realizing they have detailing we just don't do today anymore at all. David City, of course, they moved on to a new building. There you see that gable design once again, as well as the tile roofs. And again, at that entrance, they were doing something interesting with the brick patterns mm-hmm. and the window.
It's the same brick thing that was in, I think, was it the Ravenna one?
Mm-hmm.
Has that same... crosshatch sort
right.
of looking thing in the archway there.
Yeah.
Once again, a lot of hard labor by whoever the bricklayers were.
Wymore, we're seeing the renovated buildings. So you have to, and this is in my county, so I know this one. The tower you see in the center is the start of the new building to the west. So what you want to look at is the part that's actually kind of hidden behind the tree. That's the original Wymore building. And what happens when you have a building that, again, lovely little building, A lot of these have pressed tin ceilings inside. I didn't even talk about that as part of the architectural feature. And then they basically doubled their space, as you can see by that, by having the new entrance built and then picking up, again, it's not identical, but picking up a lot of the design elements for the next one. And as I said, we are getting to the end of the Carnegie program. It basically wrapped up by 1990. That was one of the last ones. So here we have Scott's Bluff in 1921, and you think, what happened? And what happened was that, of course, these people, by the time they got everything going, we all know how paperwork is, by the time they got done, the program was ending, but they still weren't done with their library. So they went on to build the library and to build onto the library again. This one tickles me because it does so many things that jump back to those first libraries. The arched windows, although it was set up so that the entrance was not centered, but on the corner today, if you can still see, this is of course the Arts Center in Scott's Bluff, but look what they did. Look what happened when they added on to this building. You can see to the right the old, that Carnegie that we saw before with the arches, but it now becomes the side and entrance. They created a new entrance and really added substantially to their space. They also, I believe that by the time they were done, that library was on four levels.
Wow.
So it made for very, this was when we moved to the Panhandle when I was in junior high, and for 1 year, I used this library, and we were all very excited about the new library, which, of course, has now been added onto in its own way, and as I said, this is now the Art Center. But it is a really interesting building, and realizing that they actually were able to add on because Scott's Bluff was so new when they got started that I don't think they realized the potential of the town. Mm-hmm. So that is one that was added onto very early on. And then I think our very last one is COSAD. And again, you can see they're taking advantage of everything that they learned by that time. They look like they have a roof system similar to Ravenna's. They have the arched windows. They have that cute little pediment doorway. They still have lots of steps. And they have, again, lot wonderful paned windows on that lower level that are going to let in a lot of light. By now, definitely, we know this is always the children's area. But it's a program, as I said, it made a big difference. 69 communities in Nebraska wound up with libraries that, I'm not going to say they wouldn't have had them, but they wouldn't have had them maybe as soon as they did, or they certainly wouldn't have had the facilities that they were able to offer the community as quickly as they did. And that's to prove that, yes, I did read one or two things. The one that most of you might be interested in is the very last book called The State of Readers by Oliver Pollack, and it is specifically about Nebraska's Carnegies, and you can just learn more stuff than you ever thought you even wanted to know about it. I recommend it highly.
We got a couple of different things here. As we were going through this, I actually added, as some of you watch our shows regularly, you know, we put links in our Delicious account related to this. And while we were doing this, because I saw the book actually sitting here next to Maureen, I put a link to the record for the book, the A State of Readers in WorldCat, into there. And also some links to where we have on our Nebraska Library Commission website information about the Carnegie Libraries and photos of all of them, where, as you said before we started this, that's where all these photos came from.
Right, they did.
We have here in our Nebraska Memories digital collection online, we have photos of them. But I do have one comment from someone that we missed one. Plattsmouth is not in the slideshow.
Well, it's not in the slideshow because the Library Commission didn't give it to me.
But I went and looked for it, and I did find a picture of it.
Good.
I know you said that, we had someone here put together everything for you of the Plattsmouth one, and I think I'll bring that up in just a second. Here,
please
look
do.
At it for you, but that's the end of the presentation.
That's the end of the presentation,
okay,
yes.
So that was actually, very interesting. Here, let me pop out of here, and I will get that up here.
Yeah, let's look at Plattsmouth a minute. Yeah, you know, I've been to Plattsmouth many times, but it's hard to get because people built other libraries based on this that they paid for in other ways. So people sometimes think something's a Carnegie and it's not.
Well, this one is, according to our commission website, it's in our collection of Carnegie libraries. So let's see here.
That's what happens when you depend on technology.
There it is.
Oh, wow. I'm glad they told about that, because look at that. Talk about architecture.
Yes, this one is just,
it's just
top,
it's
just, there. It's just amazing.
It is. It looks like they won, you know, got started and looked at the, let's see, oh, 1916.
1916,
so,
yep.
Yeah, they, that, again, it's starting to be toward the end of the program, and the opportunity to just pick up on a little bit of everything, and I think that they really did. They obviously wanted that to stand out. And for those of you who know Plattsmouth, though, that's a town of Victorian buildings. So where on one hand things like the arched windows would have fit right in, the top is certainly 1916 flavor, and yet at the same time, it's a town that's full of buildings that have a lot of that center pediment. You know, when you think about what Victorians often have at the top, where they even are telling about, they have a date or they have something up there that tells you this is an important building.
Actually, Karen, who's the director there, is saying that that's not actually not, we're going to have to get with our librarian.
Okay, I was going to say.
She says that that's not the Carnegie building. That's the building it was in before.
Oh, weird. Because I was going to say, I didn't think it was either, yeah. But I thought, you know, a lot of times they tear off something or they add on something. Mm-hmm. We will have to get the right picture. Well, what on earth was that? That building
it's
is incredible.
Pretty. It says public library. She said it's the building that the library was in before they got a Carnegie.
Ah,
so
what a fascinating thing.
Karen just sent us a picture. That would be great, yes, because I'm sure that Beth and our reference staff would like to have this correct.
Yeah, I would too. I'd like to fit it into the everything else that it looked like, because I got kind of tickled when I was looking at this and looking at it. Not the book is alphabetical, as is the collection the Library Commission had, and it's my fault that things are in a different order, because I thought it was so interesting to see how
you did it by
chronologically.
Date. Here on our website, we have the pictures alphabetically, so if you didn't want to look up your particular town or any town, you can find it on here.
Yeah, chronological would be a bear to be looking up that way, but it was fun to deal with in terms of what influenced what,
mm-hmm.
or who influenced whom.
Laura, who's at the Stanton Library, says, our library is remodeled in 1998, and the lower level is our children's department, as you said, a lot of libraries have done, and the entrance is now handicapped accessible.
Oh.
So that's what I know that some libraries do.
Bravo.
They want to stay in that nice Carnegie building because it still works, but they can retrofit it to make it actually be ADA compliant.
I used to wish that I could just go over and open a valve like you do a beach ball, just blow the building up larger. You know, if I just could have done that.
Yes, just a little bit more.
Yeah, just, right. There were so many things that I loved about the building, but there were so many things that were such a problem.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody have any other comments, questions, corrections?
Yes.
For the information?
Thank you.
Yeah.
If there's any other miss, and I should have just gone through and actually counted, but the fact that we have duplicates of some of the pictures makes, or duplicates is the wrong word, but two of some of them, and then we have some of those interior shots, meant that I couldn't use that as the count. So thank you. Right. If anybody else's is missing, I hope they tell us so we get that straight.
Well, we'll
get
this information out there that people will know that we have this on the commission website, trying to track all of this in one place. And then I would assume the book that was written
And you know, let's see if it has
a picture. I'm not sure where he got his photos, if he has them all in there.
Well, some of them he got from your collection.
I would assume so. We've been doing
Is there... But what it does say about that Plattsmouth one, it says it was built by the Young Ladies Reading Room Association. It says it was across the street from the Carnegie. Okay, so that looks, now they're saying that's the Plattsmouth Carnegie.
Okay, yep.
With an addition, right. That sounds, because I've certainly been there with the addition.
Yeah, it is a very traditional column-looking Plattsmouth one, yep. We'll get, you know, Karen said she'll send us a new one. That'd be great. We'll update our website here. We'll talk to people about that. Okay, well, we did go a bit over our time today, but fine. You know,
my apologies.
We don't have a problem with that here. This is very interesting for me, especially. I was, you always think of Carnegie Library, and they all, like, they have a look. They were cookie cutter. It was like a format, but they really weren't. It was nice to see that they were specific to each area and each town. They were allowed to, in their each individual towns, pick and choose what they wanted to do.
Exactly.
And how they wanted to look. That was very, very cool, very interesting. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Coming on here.
Thanks for inviting me.
Braving our impending snowstorm.
Yes, right.
Hopefully, our lines are closed. Hopefully, it's not here yet. That will wrap it up for today. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us. And I hope you'll join us next week when it will be our monthly Tech Talk with Michael Sowers, the Technology Innovation Librarian here at the Nebraska Library Commission. And he's going to give us a demo of Windows 8. We've got, we're not actually moving to it, but he's got one machine here where we've set it up on it so we can figure it out and see what it's all about. So if you're wondering what's up with the new Windows, you can get a demo for that next week. He'll be here the day after Christmas doing our show for you. So please.
That's dedication.
Yes. register and sign up for that. It will be recorded if you're not going to be available the day after Christmas. And we do have a Facebook page for NCompass Live, so if you do use Facebook, you can follow, like us on there, and it will give you all the information about upcoming shows, ones that have been scheduled, when our recordings are available, reminders to join today's episode, whenever it comes up, whenever it's live. So please go ahead and join us there. Other than that, we are done for this morning. Thank you very much, Lori. Thank you, everyone, for attending, and we will see you next time. Bye-bye.